things and shine.
Gotta be some. And, oh, does anybody need to fit for the N95? There are, I know last semester there was, Miss Wise was on a floor that had nothing but COVID patients. You know, I don't know, but I do know that all students have to be fitted.
Okay, yeah, I've never been fitted.
You've never been fit tested, okay. All right, anybody else not been fitted for a year?
I don't have the sheet for it or like any documentation. I don't know.
You should have had last semester documentation.
No, I didn't have it.
You didn't get fitted last semester?
No.
We got fitted in more about 106, and then yeah. I got it refitted at the hospital I work at.
If you have the hospital documentation, that'll be fine. But that's one of the things you have to upload.
So I'll have to do it.
Okay, yeah. If you don't think you can get that, we'll just do them again. And Miss Williford is doing the schedule for that. So I'll give her the names and then she'll let me know. So that means the rest of you have a document to upload that says you've been fit tested in the last, Kim, you need to be fit. All right, now the rest of you, Sheena. Well, that, are you Sheena or Sharon?
Sheena, okay.
I
feel like they
should. We got this tested last
semester,
but they didn't give us any documentation.
We had to turn it into our instructor.
And they kept it.
Yeah.
Who was your instructor?
What's it?
Collins and Miss Lake. Right.
Amy Kwan and...
No, I'm good. I think
you're cool?
Yeah.
Did you get fit tested last?
It is 2021 January. Do I need to redo it?
2021 January, you'd have to redo it.
Then, yeah, I need to redo it.
I guess we
can. I can just say who doesn't get fit tested. Okay, Samantha. And Naima, you did?
We have to turn it paper and
say that we
are
here.
So you are? I'm
pretty
sure.
Elaine.
All right.
Josh, you're good? Christina is good?
Yes, ma'am. I can bring mine for work then.
Yes, you can.
Yeah, I'll bring mine for work.
Well, just upload it. You don't have to bring it. Just upload it. So, Sharon, you're good? Okay. Natalia, do you have something to upload? Kwan, you said you did. Amber's not here. Jed, how about you? You're good. All right. Okay. All right, well, let's finish up this incontinence. Okay. Weight loss, we've talked about most of these already. You're trying to decrease the stress and the irritation with the coffee, the alcohol, citrus base, those kind of things. Okay. Surgical management had to do with fixing those prolapses and cystocele and BPH, fixing those problems. And, of course, they've got to have a consent. But post-op retention and infection with these surgeries are two
of the complications that can occur, and also anytime you fool with the renal system, hemorrhage, because it's very vascular. Not so much with these two, but retention and infection, absolutely. So these patients will have a catheter. Some of them will have suprapubic catheters, and some of them will go home with their catheters. So they need to know catheter care at home. If it's a suprapubic catheter, that'll stay in until they can void with not more than 50 residual after boarding. So they go home with their catheters. They usually come back in 2 or 3 weeks. The regular cath, they'll remove it. They'll have them void. They may do a bladder scan to be sure there's not any residual, and then they get to go home. So we need to teach them how to take care of that thing so they don't get an infection, you know, not hanging it up here like a purse, and how to clean, just use good soap and water and those kind of things. Weight, fluids, if they need to lose some weight, we need to help them with that. Fluids, they need to push their fluids so that they don't get infection. And for these patients, no more than 5 pounds weight lifting, okay? Because we don't want to put pressure on those surgery incisions, okay? They also will probably need to void at least every 2 hours so that they don't fill that bladder up too much. If they can do that, we'll see. If they've gone home with a catheter, then we need to tell them when to come in and see the physician if there were any problems. All right, so let's talk about meds. So Teradine is the, gotta go, the urge incontinence one. But remember, you may see patients on this that also have then they've got the lady up here that sneezes and pees. Okay, that's the sphincter problem. But she's probably got some mix in there. So the anticholinergic will help with that too. The Tolteridine will help with that. Now, anticholinergics have their own little set of problems that we've got to watch for with these patients if we put them on it. These are some of the other ones. Oxybutynin, this solifenacine. I added that to my PowerPoint last semester. I think that's Vesicare, which is beginning to be the more popular brand to use. So I thought I should put that up there for you because you may see that more. So eyes, it increases pressure, so you have to be very careful with glaucoma patients. It may cause them to have a little blurry vision. So you have to implement safety precautions or fall precautions and evaluate that, their vision. Urinary retention, monitor their INO. Because remember, anticholinergic dry things up and it may cause retention. We want to stop their incontinence, but we don't want them to have retention, okay? Dry mouth, give them ice chips, some non-sugar-free gum, like that. Constipation. So we need to encourage them to walk, high fiber, higher fiber, and fluids. Now remember, when you're working with patients, fluids are great for the kidneys unless they have kidney issues or they have congestive heart failure. Not so good to push fluids for them. Okay? So there's a little, I think y'all are good with this. There's a little acronym you can use anytime you have anticholinergic drugs and you're looking for side effects. You know that it can cause them can't see, can't pee, can't spit, can't do the other thing that goes with constipation. So those are the 4 side effects that you get because cholinergics dry things up. So think about, you know, that's what you would assess. I was on anticholinergic and the driest mouth ever. And they kind of were putting me on one and taking me off one, so I was kind of double dipping for about a week. I thought, I can't even open my mouth, it's so dry, it would just go
I'm like, okay. None of the other stuff bothered me though. Estrogen cream. That's why I asked to find out if they're perimenopausal or postmenopausal. As our estrogen decreases, the musculature weakens. Estrogen cream will help to increase the flow to the pelvic base. It also has enhances nerve conduction, which will help with contraction of the muscles and help keep them stronger and strengthen tissue. Okay. Tricyclics relax the detrusor muscle if they have urge incontinence. It also increases serotonin and norepinephrine. So that helps strengthen their urinary sphincter. And the uricholine is used for overflow, or if diabetics have a flaccid bladder, that stimulates the detrusor muscle. We can use it short term. All right. That is my spiel on incontinence. Questions? All right. Now we're going to start talking about inflammation and infection. And cystitis is probably one of the more common problems, everyday problems. A UTI is probably the second major diagnosis you'll see in a family practice, second to upper respiratory, colds, flu, that kind of thing. So, significant that we get enough of these. They can not only come from bacteria, but from medications that irritate the bladder, from radiation. So for a cancer patient, any kind of irritant. Coffee, my Cokes that I love to drink, can be very irritating to the bladder. And they are also, UTIs are probably the most common infection that we give our patients in the hospital. Colds from Foley's. And I'll talk about that. More than 80% of them are caused from E. coli, so who do you think gives them more, men or women? We do, because we're so close to that E. coli. And catheters, as I said, are a most common factor associated with new onset UTI in the hospital and long-term care facilities. Normally, we have mucus production, and that helps to prevent cellular damage and maintain the mucosal integrity, because the bacteria can't adhere to the walls of the epithelial lining because of the mucosa, the mucus that is produced on it. Our pH of our urine is usually around 6 to 6.5, and bacteria like to grow in alkaline urine. What makes our urine more alkaline that we've talked about?
What we drink, caffeine.
Yeah. Dehydration makes that urine more concentrated, puts our osmolarity up, puts our pH goes up and becomes alkaline, and it's a perfect breeding ground for bacteria. Urine, and then we have some natural proteins and that destroy protective antibiotics that can destroy pathogens that just kind of get up into your bladder and say, might be a good place, and those natural immunity comes in and says, nope, out, this is not a good place. And with men, it's the secretions of the prostate. It has an antibiotic effect, slight antibiotic effect that will help prevent UTIs. And of course, frequent voiding means that we're drinking enough, means that we're flushing out all those bacteria. So what kind of things contribute to a UTI? Well, anything that's going to block the flow or irritate. And stones are a big one. They block that flow, especially if they're sitting right there over the urethra. Any type of obstruction, like an enlarged prostate, because it is located around the urethra, and as it grows, it tends to grow inward. So these patients will retain urine. It sits in the bladder. They have increased chances of UTIs. Vesicle ureteral reflux in women have all that pressure. And diabetes. Oh, bacteria love sugar. If they're spilling sugar into their urine. Also, if they have peripheral neuropathy, they can get a flaccid bladder and have the urine sitting there, develop retention, and that increases the chances. We talked about the pH needing to be alkalotic. Women tend to have more because they've got just that little short range from the E. coli. Age, as women get older, and men lose the prostate secretions that help, and women lose the estrogen that changes the floor of the environment of the pelvic floor. Sexual activity can cause irritation. That's why you always need to have a glass of water and go pee after sex. Children. Children don't want to stop and go pee. My granddaughter is 4 years old. She's been peeing on the toilet for a while. But we can be playing and she'll get up and be doing this. And I'm like, you need to go to the bathroom? No, no, it's your turn, it's your turn. And she's doing this. So I just get up, take her to the bathroom. She pees. We come back. She didn't want to stop. And that's very common for children. When they're toilet training, it's hard too, because their little arms, when you first put them on the toilet, they can't really reach all the way back here and in here to get clean right. So mama's got to help, and we got to talk about front to back. We got to help them wash their hands, because they don't like to do that either. So the inadequate hygiene. Infants cannot tell you if their urine, if they hurt when they pee. Toddlers will tell you if they get a UTI, it hurts when I go pee-pee. I don't want to go pee-pee. Infants can't. They just get irritable and fussy and crying all the time. Children may exhibit abdominal or back pain, and they will tell you that it hurts the pee-pee. So we want to teach them and teach parents of newborns how to, you know, change that diaper frequently, even though the wonderful Pampers that we have now, it's hard for me to tell if they're wet or not sometimes. So it does keep it away, but we do need to keep them clean and teach them, you know, hygiene, how to toilet train your child, those kind of things. Because children can get UTIs that can cause trouble later on down because they might have recurrent UTIs. They also can have frequent UTIs because of structural problems, maybe genetic structural changes that occurred at birth that we just really hadn't noticed yet. So they'll do a uroscopy or something to check all that out. So, you know, if your small child is having a lot of UTIs, they certainly need to be seen and evaluated for that. Antibiotics, the whole course. And we always need to check when they finish that, especially if the patient or the child is having frequent UTIs, it may be that you're not finishing, the patient or the parent is not finishing all the antibiotics because the child started having diarrhea. But we got to get all those antibiotics in. So these infections can occur in the bladder, the urethra, and the kidneys. And they all have pretty much the same kind of symptoms. Urethritis, usually STDs are a common cause for this. And inflammation of the bladder is usually from the external urethra that's moved up, and or from a catheter. And I didn't mention this morning, I forgot, but 50% of catheters inserted in the hospitals will become infected within a week. That's if we put them in right, we're hoping. In most hospitals now, you have to have two licensed people when you go to put a Foley in. Because somebody's got to be watching. I have contaminated and not known it, and my little student was terrified to tell me, you touched your leg. I'm like, oh, thank you. I didn't see it. Big woman. So two people, because it can be hard. Because let me tell you, those urethras don't look anything like down there in that lab. Because anybody who's put in a phone? All right. Other than a male. Yeah, okay. Males are pretty easy. We know where to go. Well, how many of you, huh?
I said, well, sometimes.
Sometimes, yeah. I have had some that I've had a little trouble with, but much, much older. How many of you have put a Foley in the wrong hole? Yeah. So, nothing like those pretty things down there in the lab. You know, it depends on, I mean, and I would say, oh, you know, if you've had somebody that's had a lot of kids, watch out. I had, last semester, we put a Foley in this lady and went down with the student, and we had another, I think there were three or four of us down there, and I couldn't find the place to put it. The student was like, okay. And she's looking, and I'm like, what's the problem? And I knew the woman had never had any children. Nothing. And she was little. She wasn't heavyweight. She was thin. And I'll be dang, I got down there and I'm like, that we got a problem. The lady goes, let me tell you where it is. We had to lift this. And I went, oh, it was a genetic thing, you know. But it was. She laughed at us, because I thought that she could have told us that before. She she was working with that student. So catheters, as I said, we want to leave them out. They increase morbidity by a factor of 3, and that's pretty big. The pyelonephritis. Same kind of symptoms over here, but what you're going to see is a much sicker patient, and they're going to have flank pain. They're going to have fever, and they're just going to feel like crap. Okay? We'll talk about that one next week. So we want to look at the patient and what kind of things could contribute to this. If they're having frequent, then we need to do some assessment about their toileting activities. Are they a nurse and they get there at 5 o'clock in the morning and they don't pee till they go home at 4? You know, that's not unusual. Elderly will tend to decrease their intake because they're incontinent, and then they get dehydrated and concentrated urine, and now we got a UTI. So you need to assess for anything that might be contributing to frequent UTIs. Foley care, can't stress that enough. Medications that can cause retention can lead to UTIs. And lab, review that lab. Your analysis, look at cultures, because we want to know exactly what bacteria we have. And we always want to get our culture before we start any antibiotics in the hospital. Okay. Clean catch, midstream, 10 cc's, we can look at how much urine. I mean, we can look at what's going on in the urine. You're going to see leukocytes or white cells. You may see red cells. You may see nitrites. Nitrates are a natural occurring, but when a bacteria sees a nitrate and attaches, it changes to nitrite. So there'll be elevations of nitrites. And these first three are non-invasive, and we use those to see, well, is there a stone? Is there a stricture that's causing this problem? Is there something causing urinary retention? A cystoscope, let's say you don't really have symptoms of a UTI, but you've got blood in your urine, maybe a few leukocytes, but we can't figure it out, and it's higher the next time. So now we might need to go up into the bladder and see, is there anything up there causing these problems?
And then for retention or stones, then you want to look for any abnormalities. All right, so cystitis, health promotion. If, of course, sterile technique in the hospital, but if you've got a patient, let's say with MS, who does intermittent capping at home, we actually used to tell patients they could take a Foley, keep it clean, wash it after every use, and use one for a week or two. Now we have wonderful disposable little short in and out casts that we encourage people to use. They do not have to be sterile. You know, in the hospital, yes, they come to us, we are going to be sterile, because as sterile as we can be. You can't really be sterile unless you're in an OR room, but you know, sterile gloves to do a Foley catheter insertion. But the patient, when they're at home in their own environment and they're doing in and out casts, just needs clean technique. They need a clean area, they need to wash their hands. If they drop the catheter, let's go get another one. We don't need to use that one. But they don't have to be opening sterile packets and doing sterility, because their body is used to that. But when they come to the hospital, we got bad bugs that we don't want to give them, okay? So it will be sterile there. So single-use catheters are recommended now for home settings, and that is NP National Patient Safety Goal is prevention of colitis. If we have to put a Foley in, we're going to do everything we can to get it out as quick as possible and to keep that patient from getting the UTI. Liberal intake of fluids, long as their heart is okay with it. So, what are some things we want to do to prevent increased fluids? 3 liters a day, if they're able to do that. Heat to the abdomen or a warm sitz bath for the pain. And when you get a UTI and you're having all that pain, we also recommend that they can pee in that warm water. It will relieve the pain. Now, we don't want them sitting in it for a long time, but 15 minutes warm sitz bath is helpful to relieve pain. Avoiding alcohol, anything that's stimulating. Teach them how to, you know, hygiene is important. Urinate after intercourse, drink a glass of water, void every 2 to 3 hours, don't hold it. What else? What else your mama teach you? What kind of panties you need to wear? Cotton panties. Okay, what about summertime?
Don't keep a wet bathing suit on.
Bingo, I made that mistake one time. Accidentally. Don't walk around a wet bathing suit all day. Nice environment. How do I put this delicately? Don't wear panties to bed some nights. Air that thing out, you know. You don't, I mean, if you sweat a lot and you've got underwear on, it's going to produce a real nice breeding ground, so let's not do that a lot. But keeping your immune system booster, good sleep, nutrition, anything, you know, keep your support, keep yourself in good shape, that will help. All right, let's look at some antibiotic and infectives. Of course, we've got the fluoroquinolones, the penicillins, the sulfonamides. This is Bactrim. It's got a real long name. It's a combination of two drugs, but it's Bactrim. And we're going to look at these individually. These are the ones you'll see the most in the hospital. But the biggest thing is teasing to finish it all. Don't take just part of it. Take it at the same time every day so you can keep those blood levels up and actually kill the bacteria. All right, so these are our examples, the ciprofloxacin, Amoxil, and the TMP SMZ is the Bactrim. So antibiotics always have a ton of side effects, but Cipro, the fluoroquinolones are usually broad spectrum antibiotics that we start people with until we figure out exactly what the deal is going on. You can take with or without food, but you need to take it with a full glass of water. A lot of antibiotics, and Cipro is one, and Bactrim is a big one, that will crystallize
and form stones. So we want a lot of water to flush that through. Of course, we don't take in acids within 2 hours of medicines, before or after. The Cipro can cause arrhythmias or tachycardia. So if they have any feelings that their heart is racing, they need to call the physician. And we don't want to crush extended release, right? If your pill is coated, or if you have a capsule, what would you do with those? Can you crush those?
No.
The coating, those are protective. The coating dissolves slowly so that the medication is given out slowly. Same thing with the capsule. So I've seen capsules opened and put down NG tubes, but you really need to check a pharmacy on that. That's not a good idea, because that will release everything at one time. And the capsule is there to offer some delayed time with that. Another big thing, and I see this more with Levo, is tendon rupture. I've had two friends that had this from long-term use of levofloxacin. And they had pain in their Achilles tendon and ended up with a rupture. So watch for that pain. Amoxil, obviously, is going to be allergic reaction is one of the biggies. This is related to penicillin. It can be nephrotoxic, and you want to take it with food. Birth control. Bactrim and Amoxil and the penicillins are bad to interact with birth control pills. And I know several birth control babies that are now adults that their moms were on birth control pills when they were on antibiotics, and they got pregnant. So I usually, if my friends ask, say, if you're on an antibiotic and you can get pregnant, if you're on birth control pills, you need to do something else along with that. Because there are a lot of them out there, and you just either look it up and see if that's one of them, or just, I just flat out would, you know, do something other than. But Bactrim and amoxicillin are our two that we're gonna, would be looking at here. Steven Johnson syndrome. You can read these, but this is a biggie for Bactrim. It is an angry skin rash. It's almost like your skin is on fire and peeling off. I've only seen it once. It's quite impressive. So if your patient begins to have any type of redness on their skin or burning or itching, they need to call immediately. All right, so Bactrim is a drug we use a lot for UTIs. You may use it for short-term, long-term, and I never realized until I started really looking through all this, Coumadin can potentiate the effects of Coumadin, Dilantin, or Phentoin, hypoglycemics. Well, how many patients do we have on those? You know, a lot. So you really have to be careful with their labs checking all these to be sure that we're not getting hypoglycemic or bleeding. It also causes hemolytic anemia, A-grade anosmosis, thrombocytopenia. So you see, you've got to check lab when you're on these. And watch for bruising, frequent bruising, and watch for any sign of an infection, a sore throat. They don't need to be around people that could have COVID or flu. This can turn your urine dark, and we're giving it really slow over with IV. There's some other drugs we use for UTIs. The nitrofurantoin is an antiseptic. It does not get systemic, but it's used to help cleanse the bacteria in the bladder. It's not gonna fight it and kill it. It's not bactericidal like the antibiotics may be, but it's going to help. So you'll see that used with an antibiotic, or you may see it used if your patient has colonized. They don't have, and you see this a lot in long-term care facilities, they don't have an infection. They don't have signs and symptoms, but they got some bacteria in their urine. Well, you can't antibiotic them every time that happens, or they'll just build up a resistance. So you may see them use some
nitrofurantoin just to try to help keep the bladder clean and increase fluids to flush some of that stuff out. Phenazopyridium and Anastaz help with pain. You can get these over the counter now. You got to be careful because this gets rid of your pain pretty good. And that's one of the first signs when you get a UTI, it hurts to pee. This will help get rid of that. But it does not do anything for bacteria. So if you don't go see about it and you start having it again and you just take some more of this, you're just letting that bacteria grow. This does cause your urine to be red, and you need to tell them about that, because that can be really scary, because it looks like I'm getting worse, I'm peeing blood. Okay. And it will stain your clothes, and it will stain your toilet. Okay, so the nitrofurantoin, as I said, it does not go systemic. It can cause GI, so you can take some milk with it. The brown or orange urine occurs with it. Big thing on this one, flu-like symptoms, elderly, but liquid form will stain your teeth. So if you're giving it to a child or elderly, have them rinse their mouth with some water so that their teeth don't get stained, especially children. This is my pyridium, which really helps to cut down on that pain. Nutrition-wise, some other things we can use, fluids always, lots and lots of fluids. Cranberry juice. Some people swear by this, some people say it doesn't work, but I do know you have to do it every day. You can't expect to have a UTI, drink some cranberry juice and it'll help. It doesn't work that fast. You have to be on it every day. Apple cider vinegar, vitamin C, avoiding spicy foods. What these things are trying to do is increase the acidity of your urine. So for people who have frequent UTIs, this can be very helpful. As we already talked about, warm sitz baths, analgesics, and the antispasmodics. Okay, any questions? Are you out of the way? This just kind of summarizes our cystitis. Remember, our pilo is very similar, but we're going to have flank pain, fever. They're going to be a lot sicker. We talked about leukocytes. That's supposed to be nitrites, but this is a stock slide, so I couldn't change it. Elderly. Sometimes the elderly just get squirrely. They're just confused. They have no symptoms whatsoever. You work in a long-term care facility, you come in and your patient is so confused. Mm-hmm. Nothing's going on, they hadn't had a stroke, they had nothing. Check the urine, because UTIs can definitely do that. Same thing in the hospital. We have older patients come in and the family member will say they've just been so confused the last 2 days. And you check a urine and I bet they have. They've got 4+ bacteria. Because they don't always have those other symptoms, the pain and the dysuria and the frequency and all that. All right, here you go. Okay, a few little questions. Structural and functional changes occur in the kidney as we get older, just like everything else. Which of the following is not a change that kidneys undergo? So do we get decreased bladder capacity? Nocturnal polyuria, God use. Kidney enlargement, gets smaller, it shrinks just a little bit. Decreased glomerular filtration rate, yeah, just a little, it does occur. Now, neither of these last two things are enough to cause us to have renal failure. But, you know this, and you have an elderly patient come in with something that can lead to renal failure. Well, we already got 1 foot on the slippery slope here because of their age and what's going on with their body already. So we really need to be attuned to what's going on. So now we are talking to a female in a clinic, and we're teaching
Would we teach her to wipe from back to front?
No.
No. Tell her to take enough fluids to produce 7 to 12 voidings.
It's like your heads are spinning.
How much fluids do we need to take in? 2 to 3 liters. That will produce 7 to 12 voidings. Take the antibiotic until the pain subsides.
No.
Because? Finish it. Expect some flank discomfort until the antibiotic starts to work.
No.
No. What is flank? What's the flank mean?
Polynephritis.
Now our kidneys are getting involved. All right, our nurse has collected data, and which beverage do we need to eliminate to minimize the recurrence of cystitis?
Tea.
It's an irritant. It's got caffeine, alcohol, all those kind of things. We've got an uncomplicated UTI, and they're being discharged. We're doing teaching. And the client understands the information if you say, okay, so what's the right thing for them to do? Increase fluids for 2 days if signs and symptoms of a UTI develop.
No.
What's wrong with that?
2 days.
The 2 days is what's wrong. We need to increase fluids. Take the prescribed antibiotics until all symptoms subside.
No.
You need to keep doing it. Change out of a wet bathing suit as soon as possible. Yeah, we like that one. Decrease fluid intake if frequent urination occurs.
No.
All right, they're incontinent. All right, through with that. Any questions on anything we've covered this morning? Y'all need to stand up and stretch? We have got about 40 minutes. So we're going to jump into kidney stones. And I love this book.
Mr. Tribbiani. I'm afraid you've got kidney stones.
Well, what else could it be?
It's kidney stones. Or kidney stones.
A little better, sweetie?
Maybe a little. Wish you hadn't seen me throw up.
Me too.
Hey, I just heard. What's up?
Kidney stones. Now, ordinarily, Mr. Tribbiani, we try to break the stones up with shock waves, but they're too close to the bladder now, which means we can either wait for you to pass them or else go up the urethra.
No. Nothing is going up, okay? Up. Up is not an option. What's a urethra? Are you crazy? Get these things out of me! Breathe through the pain. I want the drugs!
Are you ready? It's time to try peeing.
Wait.
It's almost time to try peeing.
Oh my God.
You did it, man.
Would you like to see them?
They're so small.
I better ask about kidney stones that I would rather have a baby than pass that stuff again. And did find out that if you telling them, Mr. Glass has had a kidney stone before, and the big thing is pain, people. It hurts. It usually comes on very suddenly, and it's very painful. So where do they come from? Well, we all produce crystal junk, little grains, but only 10% of us make stones. The rest of us have inhibitor substance. People that have made stones have been found to have less of that inhibitor substance. And these are the four common: calcium, cysteine, oxalate, uric acid. This same stuff that makes gout. And calcium is the most common of those, okay? And you get super saturated with the whatever it is making it, such as the calcium or the uric acid, and it crystallizes into stones. They can It's a great place for bacteria. Dadgummit, I left those stones again. I'll try to bring them next week. I have a little cup with some stones in them that Dr. Neal gave me when she passed them. And I forgot them. They're sitting on my desk. So, anyway, get back where I was. Okay, so the stones and cells are different shapes and sizes, but a lot of them are very prickly, like a little prickly pear, and they're passing through the smooth endothelial of the GU system, and it is very painful. They rip through there. I've got some videos, and you can see what it's doing to the lining of the ureter that it's going through. Now, a nidus is the crystal aggregation of all that making the stone, and it can become infected. It can carry bacteria on it, so these patients have an increases of UTIs also. Calcium oxalate, as I said, is probably the most common, and one of the big complications that occur from this is if that stone gets in the ureter and blocks the passage of urine. Well, the kidney's still making urine, right? So that urine keeps going, and it can't go anywhere, and it starts to back up, and the ureter will get big, and then it'll get in the kidney, and the kidney will start swelling. But you know, it's encapsulated. That's not something that we can walk around with a kidney this big because it's all swollen in there. Although we do get bigger kidneys, but we'll, never mind, talk about that later. The kidneys they'll only swell so much, and then the pressure builds up, okay? And when pressure builds up, it damages our kidneys. So patients with a stone can develop hydronephrosis from that ureter being blocked and go into renal failure within a 24-hour period, quickly. So we really have to keep a watch on their urine output. And I talk about my favorite word, trends, okay? Because we got another kidney over here that's working fine, peeing, sending its urine out. So their urine output may be okay, but when this one stops, then it's gonna be going down. The trend is gonna be this. That means, hey, we need to take a closer look. They'll probably do CTs on these patients to determine where the stone is, if it's blocking anything. Do we have urine output? Is our urine output decreasing? Are they having pain? More pain than normal, constant. So we have to follow those things. Some risk factors. The biggest risk factor of developing a stone is if you've already had one. So easy risk, more than you are. But it does tend to run, and we see it in families. So there's something genetic there too. Family history of diabetes, obesity, gout, and their diet can affect it, and their urine pH can affect it. Excess excretion through the kidneys of the oxalate, the calcium, the uric acid, they start accumulating and forming stones. And we're going to look at a diet in just a couple slides over that can increase that. So, you have a patient that comes in, your main priority is kind of twofold. We want to treat their pain. They're going to be in pain. Some patients will get by with Toradol, a non-steroidal. Most patients don't. Anybody had stones? Anybody else had stones? If y'all don't want to share, that's fine. I always ask that for everything. So. I won't ask you if you've ever had an STD or anything like that. But I do like, if y'all can share, I love the stories. But you're going to be treating their pain. They're going to have all these symptoms like Joey did. They're going to have the blood. And you're going to be watching for complications, the hydronephrosis. Now, how would I know that? They're going to have even more pain. And they're going to have a decrease in their urine output. They're going to see this on CT, and they usually take, did you get a CT to determine where yours was? They're going to look where it is because
as you describe the pain too, that can give you an idea of where the stone is. And if we have a stone that's blocking urine flow, then we have a chance of hydronephrosis and we have a chance of renal failure. So you as the nurse are going to be monitoring for that. Okay? Labs. CT is probably the most common. Here's a nice picture of a big old stone and some little ones sitting here at the opening of the urethra. That's not going to let flow come through. We're going to have to get that, bust that up, get that out. Sometimes if we determine that the stone is small enough, we still got good urine flow going, they'll send the patient home, what I think you did, for about a week on fluids, try to pass it, move around. If it gets worse, or when they come back in a week, we're not making any progress, then they're going to go in and take it out. And they may have to go up, like Joey said, or we can do it outside the body. Okay? There's a couple of ways to do that. Our nursing management, so, is going to be pain, infection control, looking for complications, and the lithotripsy is non-surgical. If we do an extracorporeal outside the body, we'll talk about that in just a second, then minimally invasive procedures, and then we have an open procedure. And all this, we're trying to prevent any infection and keep that obstruction from happening. So I already talked about the pain control. This is usually going to be Dilaudid, an opioid, because Toradol generally doesn't help most people. There it is. But it does some. I've had patients that the Toradol was fine, and they did fine with it, but a lot of times it's going to be the morphine or the Dilaudid. If your patient is going for a lithotripsy, you have to stop the non-steroidals because it will increase your chance of bleeding. And the lithotripsy, oh, and antispasmodics also. And the lithotripsy actually can cause some bruising, so you don't want to increase your chances anymore for bleeding. So drug therapy, we have certain things that help depending on the kind of stone you have. Thiazide diuretics help to promote calcium reabsorption back into the body, but you have to be careful with dehydration because it also makes you pee. That can get dehydrated, and dehydration is one of the big things that can lead to a stone formation. Okay. Allopurinol is also is the uric acid thing. Same thing we treat with gout. It also helps the oxalate ones. ACE inhibitors help to lower cysteine levels, which diminishes aggregation of stones and the making of the stone. Sodium bicarb is going to alkalinize the urine, which is good for not producing stones. And diets, low sodium increases calcium reabsorption back into the body, out of the bloodstream, back into the body. So that would be helpful. Low protein also helps with that. So nutritionally, we want a low sodium diet because that calcium gets back into the body out of the bloodstream. We want lower protein. Lemons is another kind of a therapy. I have actually seen research on this, and you can get online and look at blogs, and people swear by this lemon. But again, we're increasing the concentrate of citrates, which decreases stone formation. Okay? And then decreasing acidic foods and avoiding megadoses of vitamin C. Those are some alternative therapies. Preventive nutrition, again, just excessive intake of protein and sodium can lead to more stones, calcium of oxalate.
oxalates, things that are, have oxalate in them, thank God, because I don't like them. Rhubarb and beets, we don't have to eat, yay, but I do like spinach. But those foods can increase the risk of stone if you're a formation, if you're a stone former. Limit your alcohol. There's my increasing fluids again. And this is an interesting little one, the cystine stones. People that make frequently have cystine stones. Dehydration is tremendously a big cause of them making more stones again. They have to keep their fluids going 24 hours a day. You know how we get up in the morning and we're like, ugh, first thing I want to do is have a big glass of water. And because we haven't had anything to drink in 8 or however many hours you're going to sleep. They have to set an alarm about halfway through, get up and drink a glass of water. And if they get dehydrated, they'll get stuck. So they have to be really careful about all that. So, what do we teach our patients? All this stuff we just talked about, what makes it worse? How to help them diminish by talking, telling them about dehydration, the stasis, the retention, immobilization. Our patients that are paralyzed, especially quadriplegics, they're not putting weight on their bones like we normally do, and they tend to leach calcium out of their bones because the calcium stays in there as long as we're using and walking, put pressure on them. That's the way we were built. But they found that immobilized patients will leach out calcium and it gets into the bloodstream and they make more stones. They have more incident of stones. It's one of the reasons. There's lots of reasons. But, you know, we always try to get patients upright however they can. They have new stuff to help paraplegics and quads stand up and put that normal pressure on their bodies because there's so many things that affects. So many things. So, ambulation, all these things. A lot of this, if you remember, our ambulation helped with constipation, would help keep us from getting UTIs. Warm baths we used when we had them. Increase fluids and watch for infections from those stones that get in there. Alright, so this lithotripsy. Extracorporeal shockwave lithotripsers work outside the body. They use sound waves, laser shock waves. Patients are NPO for about 8 hours beforehand. There's no incision, no drains. We're just pounding on their bodies, basically. They're hooked up to an EKG because you don't want to, that you can trigger VTAC if you occur on the depolarization or repolarization line, so we want to watch that. They will use a topical anesthetic. They find out where the stone is, and then they put that shock wave on there. I used to know, like, I want to say it's 5 to 10,000 things a minute. They're breaking that stone up, okay? And they break it up so that after this, you can pee it out. That'd be nice. Doesn't always work. Sometimes we've got to use, to go up in there and break it up, or go up in there with a basket and take it out. So this is a basket, this is a lithotripsy, not the basket retrieval. And this is, I found this because they're advertising this particular device, but it's pretty cool because it goes, you take it up in there and it releases this little sheath that keeps the stones that are breaking off from going back up in the kidney. And the other thing I like about this video is that there is an animated portion and there's a real portion. Look at the epithelial lining and what's going on in that ureter. so one thing about this, because you're, they can develop a little bruise at the site. And a little bruise is fine. Put some ice on it, it'll be fine. But if it starts getting bigger, then we're bleeding, and we need to notify the physician of that. That's a problem. Okay? All right, this is our stone basket. And this is minimally invasive. They take the scope up there, they release the basket, it scoops around the stone, and they bring it out. Now, we've got also got a retrograde and a percutaneous ureterolithotomy and a percutaneous nephrolithotomy, whether they're going to go in there and remove stones in different ways. So let's look at some of this. Stenting, when they put stents in, they're trying to dilate the ureter to let a stone come through. Or maybe they've taken the stone like that guy's, and he saw how red and irritated it was. Sometimes he'll leave a stent in there to help to heal before. And also, he had some more stones. Did you see the other stones behind him on that one? I think that's the one that he had more stones. That's the same thing. So the percutaneous ureterolithotomy and nephro means that I'm going to put some kind of advancing stent in here, and I'm going to take my lithotripsy either down into the ureter to get it out with a stone basket or break it up if it's up high and I couldn't get to it going up, or it may be in this renal pelvis and I'm going to remove it through there. These patients will come back usually with some kind of drain, a Penrose. They may even have a stent or a nephrostomy tube that's put in that's draining urine, okay, because his kidney is going to be producing urine. So sometimes they'll put those drains or a stent or a nephrostomy tube in order to drain the urine here so that we give this time to rest. So as a nurse, you need to be sure that whatever it is draining. If it's supposed to be draining urine, then it needs to be draining urine. If it's a Penrose drain, and that sounds a little weird, but I have seen those put in, and urine's coming out of them, and I'm like, what the heck? You put an ostomy bag over it, protect that skin, and now we can also get an output on it of what it's doing, because we need to be sure that that's still draining. If they start having back, shoulder pain, and you check and there's no urine coming out of that, if it's a nephrostomy tube, we don't routinely irrigate those, but if they're having pain and that thing's not draining, then you might need to with like 5 cc's, but you need a physician's order for that, okay? And as far as positioning, those patients, the renal nurses I talked to said they'll stay off of it. You know, they'll find a comfortable position. So we generally just let them be comfortable as long as they're not having any pain or it doesn't block the draining of the urine that they need. Okay. Now that urine, if they've had these procedures, may look a little reddish pink for the first 12 to 24 hours because you've been in there fooling around, but it should get better after that. Okay. All right, this is a stone basket retrieval. We're gonna go up in here and snag us a new stone. This is the one that looked behind it when he gets up in here. I get impatient. All right, there's our stone. And that's not unusual. It jumped back when you touched it. Like, no, I don't want to go. But this person apparently makes stones because there's a big glob of them behind it. But this big one apparently looks big enough that it could cause some problems. So they're going in there. They just, you know, let the basket out. They're going to wrap around it. This one is not as spiky as some. But it's got those little hard nodules on it, and it's a fairly good size. All
and once they get control of it, then they just take it on out. And if it's this big and it's up in the closer to the renal pelvis, this is when you'll see them going in through a stent or whatever to go through the pelvis and into the top of the ureter to get those big things out. Because this one probably would not go all the way down through the ureter. All right, so sometimes we've got them so big that they'll go in there and do a nephrostomy where they leave an opening for urine to come out with a nephrostomy tube that will definitely have to be measured. And they'll divert the urine for a while until that area can heal, okay? The client post-op, you need to monitor their outputs, their drainage, what type it is, and again, 12 to 24 hours, it's going to be pinkish red. And again, with GU, any type of GU surgery, output, hemorrhaging, infection. Those are the three biggies that we're going to be watching for, okay? So, if we get a stone, if they've had stones, we might not be asked to strain the urine, but you might be. And so you would strain that urine through, they have not like a paper kind of thing that'll let the urine go through, and you get the stones and you send it to the lab to see what kind they are. May not get that, so don't always expect it, because if they already know they're a calcium stone producer, then we don't need to be checking for more. Routine, the three top biggies that I said. Fluid intake, big for after stones have been removed, because we don't want any more stones to get stuck in there. And the patients need to know they don't need to be getting dehydrated. That's one of the big things that will keep them from having it again. Monitor their temp, maybe on antibiotics. We've talked about diet therapy for the different stones. So here's some great little pictures. That one up there, just I can't even imagine that going through my ureter. This one's real rough. This looks more like the one we saw him pull out with the nephrostomy. All right. And I have got a great, it must be on the next week's slides, but just a little overview of renal calculi. Remember, they're very painful. And how we treat. So when you're studying, and you can say, okay, renal calculi, how would I assess if somebody has it? What am I going to see? The pain, the nausea, am I going to be able to tell where it is? What, go through the assessment of it. What's the patho behind it? What makes them form? And then look at what kind of problems? Well, urinary elimination, hydronephrosis, biggie. How am I going to know that? What am I going to be looking for if they're getting hydronephrosis? And so just talk your way through it, and then interventions. What do I do to help this? So if you talk your way through a concept map, or even write it down, we have a lot of students write it down, you'll go through all the possibilities. I'm going to talk about some more things in orientation next week that will help, but those are some of the big ones. And I know students don't like concept maps, and I didn't like them to begin with, but now I understand how much they will help you understand these concepts. Questions? Because, yay, it is so time. We're going to stop here because the next thing is urothelial cancer, and don't leave on me yet. Oh, that's not bad. Okay.
so you can get your